I would just like to take a few moments and just begin to look at some things. And we talked about the covenant and the purpose of Pesach. We also, Jesus looked at the importance of this meal. But I want us to focus on the situation of what was going on. And if I could, for a few minutes, I would just talk about coming and going. You remember when you was a child and you would be all over the place and your grandparents would say, that child don't know whether they coming or going. And that's kind of like the nation of Yisrael in their situation. But I'm here to remind you and I'm going to help you and just begin to elaborate on some things, coming and going. Because when you read the story of what took place in Mizraim, Israel was coming out of something, praise y'all. And he was bringing them out of something, and they were going somewhere. And so if you would, let's turn to the book of Ecclesiastes 1 and 9. Now, I'm going to have to go back and forth because, you know, I'm all Mac everything. But I got my MacBook over there in my bag. So let's go to Ecclesiastes 9 and 1. I mean 1 and 9, I'm sorry. Thank you, Maury. Ecclesiastes 1 and 9. And it reads as follows. The thing that has been, it is that which shall be. And that which is done is that which shall be done. And there is no new thing under the sun. The thing that hath been, it is that which shall be. And that which is done is that which shall be done. And there is no new thing under the sun. Now, if you would, let's go turn to Yeshayahu or Isaiah 46 and 10. Isaiah 46 and 10. Y'all bear with me because I'm going back and forth here. Isaiah 46 and 10. Say amen when you have it. Amen. Had to take y'all back to church. Okay then. Declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. Now, when we begin to examine these two passages of scripture, we see that he's talking about something that's going to take place in the future, but he has already declared it at the beginning. Now, when we begin to look at the story of Yisrael, the nation of Yisrael in Mizraim, we begin to see a condition that they were in. In our Moray Lamont, you already talked about some future prophecies that he's going to go in later on. Now, when we begin to look at and examine where the nation of Yisrael is, they are in a condition as a people. Now, what we have here is when we begin to look at our story, we see the conditions that they were in, servitude and bondage. Now, we read about the 12 tribes, and we read about this nation being in bondage under Mizraim and under the so-called Egyptians. Now, let me clarify something. Now, you know, during the time that they lived in, that there was no such thing as a people called Egyptians. There was no such thing as a land called Egypt. That term means bondage, or it comes from the Hebrew word metzar, mean double straits or distress. Now, today we are in a situation that's like or similar to that. Now, what we see that what happened in Mizraim, we're all familiar with the story. We're familiar with the miracles that were worked by Ab-Yehul and how he delivered and brought us out as a nation. Now, these stories are not placed in the scripture for you to read and just say, oh, that was wonderful. Now, let's go over to 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, and we're going to read verse 1 through 11. 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter. And we are going to read verse 1 through 11. Moreover, my brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea, all and were all immersed under Musa of Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, and did all drink the same spiritual drink. For they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Mashiach Yahusha. But with many of them, Yahuwah the Elohim was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Y'all keep that in mind. They were what in the wilderness?
Overthrown
in the wilderness. Didn't he say that which has happened shall be, and that which shall be has happened? Okay. They were all overthrown in the wilderness. Now, these things were our what? Example. I'm going to say that one more time. Now, these things were our examples to the intent we should not lust after evil thing as they also lusted. Very important. Now, he said these things were for our what? Our example. So if these things were for our example, if what has already happened, and he's saying that this is going to happen again, why do y'all think he loved us enough to leave these stories in the scriptures? I tell people all the time, you know the easiest way to make it into the kingdom? Do the opposite of what your ancestors did. It's just that simple. Do the opposite of what they did. How do you know what they did? It's written in the scriptures. Now, that's very important. Now, let's go look at something right quick. And we're going to get into salmon and stuff. Let's look at something there, because remember, when he brought the nation, or when he brought Yisrael out of Mizraim or Egypt, something that took place that's very important. Matter of fact, let's go over to the 16th chapter. Let's turn to Ezekiel, the 16th chapter. Let's see something right quick. When we go to Ezekiel, or Yekizikael, let's go to the 16th chapter. We're going to start at the first verse. I want to tell y'all to say amen when you have it, but I don't even have it yet. Ezekiel 16, beginning at the first verse. And again the word of Yahuwah came unto me, saying, Son of man, cause Jerusalem to know her abominations, and say, Thus saith Yahuwah Elohim unto Jerusalem, Thy birth and thy nativity is of the land of Canaan. Thy father was an Amorite, and thy mother an Hittite. And as for thy nativity in the day thou wast born, now check this out, let's read it again. And as for thy nativity in the day thou wast born, thy navel was not cut, neither was thou washed in water to supper thee. Thou wast not salted at all, nor swaddled at all. None I pitied thee to do any of these things unto thee, to have compassion upon thee. But thou wast cast out in the open field, to the loathing of thy person in the day that thou wast born. Y'all notice he keep using the word born? There's a birth taking place, right? Okay then, it said, and when I passed by thee and saw thee polluted in thine own blood, I said unto thee, when thou wast in thy blood, live. Yea, I said unto thee, when thou wast in thy blood, live. I have caused thee to multiply as the bud of the field, and thou hast increased and waxen great, and thou art come to excellent ornaments, dressed of fashion, and thine hair is grown, whereas thou wast naked and bare. Now when I passed by thee and looked upon thee, behold, thy time was the time of love. Now when I passed by thee and looked upon thee, behold, Thy time was the time of love, and I spread my skirt over thee and covered thy nakedness. Yea, I swear upon thee and enter into a covenant with thee. Very important. He entered into what with them?
Covenant.
A covenant. When they were naked, he did what? He clothed them. Okay. That sounds like a love affair, doesn't it? He said, I clothed thee also with broidered work and shod thee with badger skin, and I girded thee about with fine linen and covered thee with silk. I decked thee also with ornaments, and I put bracelets upon thy hand and chains upon thy neck. And I put a jewel on thy forehead and earrings in thine ears and a beautiful crown upon thy head. Now, when he found us, weren't we in a hot mess?
Yeah.
Y'all familiar with Beyonce's song, Let Me Upgrade You? Is that not what he did for our people?
Absolutely.
That's what he did. Now, he said, thou was decked with gold and I just, and silver, and thy raiment was of fine linen and silk and broidered work, and thou did eat fine flour, honey, and oil, and thou was exceedingly beautiful, and thou didst prosper into a what? Kingdom. And thy renown went forth amongst the heathen for thy beauty. For it was perfect through my comeliness, which I have put upon thee, said Yahuwah Elohim. Now, what you have here, you see the birth and nativity of a people. Now, what we must realize and understand for educational purposes here now, when the nation or when the children of Israel came out of Mizraim, he brought them out and took them into a place. It was out of Mizraim that they were birthed into what? A nation. When they were birthed into a nation, he gave them a written agreement, something that the world called laws. But when it comes to a kingdom and being a nation, what's the one thing you have to have? A constitution. What we're calling laws are the instruction on how to live, how to love Elohim first, how to love your brother, how to raise your kid, how to eat in cleanliness. All of these things are laws which became a constitution to govern the nation of Yisrael. Very important. Now let's go over to Bereshit or Genesis 15, and we're going to start at the 14th verse. Bereshit or Genesis, the 14th verse. Because one thing about us as the nation of Yisrael, you must keep in mind something. Now, if he said there's nothing new under the sun, that which shall be has already been, and that which has been shall be. The one thing you have to keep in mind is the coming out of Mizraim is very important and is comparable and similar to coming out of this captivity. Because what you have to realize, he brought them out of Mizraim, and he birthed them into a nation. Now, when we read the Hebrew scriptures, one thing we have found out about the nation of Israel, they've been in captivity under a lot of people and a lot of time. But what makes this captivity different than all the other ones? This is the one captivity where we have been total dismantled and assimilated as a people. Y'all get that? This is the one captivity where we have been dismantled and disassembled as a people until you don't even really know your tribe. Now, we can take a good guess and say I'm from this tribe or that, but 100% assurance that we don't know. Everybody agree? Okay, then. So that's what makes this captivity so important to be able to realize and folks to understand what's going on. When we go to Bereshit of Genesis 14, it reads as such. And when Abram heard that his brother was taken captive, Yeah, 15. Bereshit 15 and 14. Bereshit 15 and 14. I apologize again. I mean, let's start at verse 13. Now we'll start at verse 12. And when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram. And lo, an horror of great darkness fell upon him. And he said unto Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge. And afterward shall they come out with great substance. Very important. He said, know for a surety these hard-headed people are going to go into captivity and serve in the land 400 years. Now, when we look at it, it's very important to understand something was going on. Because let me tell you something about the nation of Yisrael. It's very easy for us to forget where we are. We have assimilated into the nation, so until, do y'all realize, very few of us realize we're in captivity? Anybody here got a dollar bill or any kind of money? Put it on and look at tell me who pictures you see on it. Y'all remember when Mashiach told Peter, render unto Caesar, what did he say? Render unto Caesar, what is Caesar's? Didn't he say you will be a naked as one of all things? Anything you need, you're going to have to go to those that rule over you. So what you have to realize, always remember, you're in captivity. You're in captivity because you're not in your homeland. Are you? That's why it's always very important to realize your situation. Don't forget where you are. Because let me tell you something about us. We can get a new Mercedes or a new BMW or something and think we've arrived and we've made it. But you're in error. How do you know you haven't made it? You still have to finance it, don't you? You still got to pay for it. You're giving the money to somebody else. Let me tell you something about when the Father favored you. When he favored Yisrael, we're going to see what he did. When you're favored by Yahuwah, you don't owe nobody or give nobody anything. Because it's from him. I can say he blessed me all day long. I got a $250,000 house. But after they add the interest on it, I'm paying $345,000. We have laws against that. So how would it be a blessing from him? So these are the things that should remind us where we are. Because let me tell you something. When Apostle Shaul said all these things are for an example, always realize that which has taken place, it's going to happen again. But if you don't know who you are and where you are, you'll miss the boat. And we're going to get on these boats after a while, too. So always remember, because it's so easy for us to forget that we're in captivity. You got to realize you're the only people in these lands who have been brought here against their will. Know this. So this is what makes the scripture so important. Now let's go read something. He said, know for sure these people shall go into captivity. How long? For 400 years. Now, let's go over to Deuteronomy 28:64-68. We're going to read some things. Because remember, he said these nations that he's going to deliver them from, he's going to judge them afterward, right? Deuteronomy 28:64. Through 68. And Yahuwah shall scatter thee amongst all people, from one end of the earth even unto another. And thou shalt serve other Elohims, which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone. Do I need to even deal with that? He said you're going to serve what? Other Elohim. Why is he specifically saying wood and stone? Think about the nation of Yisrael. What two things are the biggest strongholds against us when it comes to understanding who we are and falling after other foolishness. The cross and the cobblestone. Let me tell you something about the next y'all straw. There's only two things that we get caught up in when it comes to these things. Islam being the cobblestone and Christianity being the cross. Now, I was in a discussion with someone this past Shabbat, and our discussion was about these things. I said, now, when you tell me that you are a Christian, I said, my thing is, are you identifying with a religion, or are you telling me that's your nationality? Because when I say to you that I'm an Israelite, and the Israelites did not have a religion, they discontinued from their heritage, which was part of their culture, their lifestyle. I said, now, when I'm an Israelite, I'm saying I descend from who? Jacob, whose name was changed to what?
Israel.
So when I say I'm an Israelite, that means I'm a descendant of this particular lineage or seed. I said, but when you tell me you are a Christian or a Muslim, that's not an identity of your nationality. You're telling me which religious perspective you conform to and endorse. That's what you're telling me. So you have to be able to understand that when I say that we don't have a religion, I said, when we read this book, I said, remember, my people had never had anything called a Bible or a Biblios. I said, they had scrolls. And I said, now, what you call the Bible, we identify as the Hebrew Scriptures. They are the words of who? Of Yahuwah, presented to a certain particular people. Now, with that being said, you notice everything we read, it's been pertaining to who? It's been pertaining to the nation of Yisrael. He said, know for sure that these people shall what? Be in captivity 400 years. Now, when we go to Deuteronomy 28:6-8, it says, and among all nations shalt thou find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest, but the sovereign Elohim shall give thee there a trembling heart and failing of eyes and sorrow of mind. And thy life shall what? Hang in doubt before thee, and thou shalt fear day and night, and shall have none assurance of thy life. In the morning thou shalt say, would Yahuwah it were even. And at even thou shalt say, would Yahuwah it were morning. For the fear of thine heart, wherewith thou shalt fear, and for the sight of thine eyes, which thou shalt see. And the sovereign thou, Yahuwah, shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships. Now, he said the sovereign would bring us where? Back into Egypt with ships. Did they take ships into Egypt the first time? So you know this would not be the land that they call Egypt today. We're going back to that term bondage. He said, but this time I'm going to bring you in with ship. By the way, where I spake unto thee, thou shalt see it no more again, and there ye shall what? Be sold unto your enemies for what? Bond men and bond women, and no man shall buy you. Now, you know that word buy, it means what? To redeem. That's an old Quaker English word, mean to redeem. Now, let's go over to the book of Joel, the third chapter. The book of Joel, the third chapter. See, because when we look at these things, Mashiach, he's doing something. He brought us what? Out of captivity to take us somewhere else. There was a land promised to Abraham and our forefathers, which we are to inherit. Now, just a reminder of what happened and where we are to confirm what I said. Joel, the third chapter. For behold, in those days and in that time, when I shall bring again the captivity of Yehuda and Yerushalayim. For behold, in those days and in that time when I shall bring again the captivity of who? Yehuda and Jerusalem. So is he not saying that? Where should Yehuda and Jerusalem be? Aren't we supposed to be in captivity? That's why you don't have a homeland to return to as yet. It's being occupied. That's why you can't get out of this land like you want to and return home. Because you're in the condition that he said you would be in. Okay, then I will also gather all nations and will bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat and will plead with them, therefore my people and for what? My heritage, Yisrael or Israel. Now, didn't we just read, he said, the nation that they go in to serve for 400 years, he said after he bring them out, he was going to what? Didn't he say he was going to judge that nation? Okay, then. I will also gather all nations and will bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat and will plead with them, therefore, my people and for my heritage, Israel, whom they have scattered amongst the nations and parted my land. So where's the nation of Yisrael? Scattered amongst all nations. And what has happened to his land? Is it not been divided and parted? You got one group of people on one side saying that the land belonged to them. You got another group of people on the other side saying the land belonged to them because they were there first. But did he not just tell you what was going to happen to his land? He said his land would be parted and y'all would be scattered into all nations in captivity. But he said, I'm going to call these nations together and I'm going to do what? And I'm going to judge them. Now, he said, and they have cast lot for my people and have given a boy for a harlot and sold a girl for wine that they might drink. He's very specific about what has happened here. Now, for y'all that don't know, if you go back and study the transatlantic slave trade, when the Arabs begin to sell the slaves to the British and the Portuguese, you know what was the one commodity that they traded the females for? They traded the female slaves for rum and wine. That's recorded, written history. But then he said, "Thou have sold my people into the Grecians." Who y'all thought the Grecians were? Y'all called them all these other names. That's called collusion. This is how they deceive and fool and beguile the people. They tagged all these other names on people. But if you begin to study history, you'll see that these people are the same people. You'll find out that Rome and Greece were the same people. They're the same lineage of people. Now, I know that's new to some of y'all, but you need to study more. When we look at these things, we can see what Yahuwah is doing here. Okay, then he said, yeah, and they have cast lots for my people and have given a boy for a harlot. Is not that what they did? They didn't call them harlots, though. They called them what? They called them bucks. They called them studs. And they studded them out to who? The other slaves to produce what? Other strong slaves. But we know that was against our culture. He said, what? You have given a boy for a harlot, and you have sold a young woman that you might have what? Wine to drink. Yea, and what have you to do with me, O Tyre and Zidon, and all the coast of Palestine? Will ye render me a recompense? And if ye recompense me swiftly and speedily, will I return your recompense upon your head? It said, because ye have taken my what? My silver and my gold and have carried into your temples my goodly pleasant things. The children also of Yehuda and the children of Jerusalem you have sold unto the Grecians that you might remove them what? Far from their borders. Now, the importance of this is, did he not tell us no longer will they sing about how he brought the children of Israel out of where? Out of Mizraim? But this time they're going to sing about how he brought them from where? The four corners. It's the same thing all over again, but it's on a larger scale, a magnitude. The same thing. It's a reason why you're scattered in these lands. It's a reason why you're struggling and going through the thing you're going through. But my purpose today is to just keep you encouraged and don't get hard. Because let me tell you one thing. Pharaoh is going to let you go. You might not think so, but he is. He's going to let you go. Believe that. But the thing to keep in mind, we have to make sure we stay steadfast and unmovable. And we have to make sure we keep our mind in the right place. Our mind should be on learning much of this Torah as we can and preparing what? To get ourselves out of this place or preparing ourselves to leave this place. And that's the one thing we're not doing. Let me tell you something. If you're sitting around here trying to build a $200,000 and $300,000 house and you're sitting here investing in this and that, you know what that tells me? You're not trying to go anywhere. You're planning to stay here. Why would you do that? And he told you to do what? Store your riches in Shamayim. If you're trying to store your wealth and riches here, that means you're trying to stay here. You're not even preparing or even trying to go. You know this land is not your home. Our ancestors used to sing songs, I'm just a pilgrim traveling what? Or passing through what? This barren land. Swing low, sweet chariot, coming to carry me back, carry me home. They weren't talking about dying. They knew where they were from. Do y'all not know before the slaves, there was nobody ever singing songs about going to Zion? Because they nobody else was from Zion. That's why the slave master would say, sang us one of your Negro spirituals. They were the only people ever sing about going back to Zion. That's why they would say, Kumbaya. Come by here, y'all. Oh, y'all, Kumbaya. That's not an African song like they tell you. No, that's an Israel song. Our ancestors were saying Kumbaya. Come by here. Now, when we always keep in mind, don't forget where you are. Because if you forget where you are, you'll miss your deliverance. And we have a knack for not understanding what's going on in Scripture. When it came to one of our former leaders, Moshe, we know he was educated. He was reared in the house of the Egyptians. But what happened to him one day? Did he not see the mistreatment and the plight of his brothers? And what did he do? Did he make 180? Well, let me get my math right here. What's half of 360? 180. Did he make a 180-degree turn? And that's what's wrong with us as a people. Sometimes we don't see the plight of, well, how much time I got? 13 minutes. Okay, then I'm going to wind up. Sometimes we don't see the struggles that, as a nation, at what our brothers and sisters are going through. Sometimes we let positions and stuff go to our head. And it brings us out of that place where we used to be able to identify with one another. Now, since I'm getting a few more dollars an hour, I think I'm better than you. And I will look and I will see others mistreat you and not say a thing or not do a thing and not come to your cause. And that's what has taken place with the nation of Yisrael. Do you not know that there's some truth to the divide and conquer? That a house divided cannot stand? That's what's wrong with us. We don't know how to come together. We don't know how to be a nation. We've been taught how to be divided. We've been taught how to hate one another. But as the people of Yisrael, we have to do better by one another. We have to understand the situation we're in. We have to understand our environment. Now, is it the children of Judah and the children of Jerusalem ye have sold unto the Grecians that ye may remove them far from their border? Behold, I will raise them out of the place where ye have sold them, and I will return your recompense upon your head, your own head. Is that not what happened to Mizraim? Did he not raise them out of captivity? Did he not judge who? Did he not judge the Egyptians? It's the same thing all over again. He's bringing you out of captivity to take you into the land which was promised to your forefathers. But because we're so hard-headed and disobedient, it's hard for us to stay in the land. And then the scripture says, is Israel a homeborn slave? We're the only people that we've been in captivity so long, we've been out of our land longer than we've been in the land. But y'all know that we were talking about this covenant. The first thing that comes with this covenant is Shema, listen, or obedience. We're people, we don't like to listen. We don't like obedience. Why is that? But just like they were overthrown in the wilderness, didn't it say Yahuwah was not pleased with them? He overthrew them in the wilderness? Did he not say 2/3 of his people shall be cut off? Always know he's true to his word. He promised to deliver you and bring you out of captivity. But let me tell you something, coming out of captivity is something totally different than going and inheriting the land. It takes some work for that. Now, right quick, we're going to go to, Luke 1, 68 through 75. Luke, the first chapter, for y'all Greeks, that'll be Lucas. Luke 1, we're going to begin at the 68th verse. We're going to see the same thing happening again. Because the nation of Yahshua has to be redeemed and what? And saved. When we get to Luke 1 and 68, blessed be the sovereign Elohim of Israel. Let me say that one more time because, see, we don't like to get personal like this book does. We be skating around stuff, act like we scared to say something. Let me tell y'all something. This book is personal. If you don't believe me, go back and read the 23rd Psalm by Daoud. He said, the sovereign is my shepherd. He said, I shall not want. He maketh me. Is that not personal? And see, let me tell you something about the Most High. This book is about him and the people that he loved. I'm not saying he's excluding anybody else, but we have to learn how to put, Moray Matayahu did a wonderful teaching about who is the director, who's the main star. And see, when it comes to this book, we haven't been down and tried to show as a people, we're scared to take ownership and possession of the writings and the book. Not me. This book is personal. Something happened with this group of people. You ever notice the book is about what? A marriage, divorce, reconciliation? Who is the people that were betrothed and married? Who were the people that were divorced? Who are the people he's talking about reconciling with? Okay. Luke 1, starting at 68. And I'm going to come get some of that salad, y'all eat. Blessed be the sovereign Yahuwah, the Elohim of who? Israel. For he hath visited and what? Redeemed his people. Now, and hath raised up a horn of what? Salvation for us in the house of who? His servant Daoud. That's David for some of y'all. As he spake by the mouth of his set-apart prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be what? Saved from our enemies and from the hand of all that what? Hate us. Is this not the same thing that was going on in Mizraim? Is there anything different than what took place in Mizraim? And see, that's another thing. Let me tell y'all something. The nation of Yahshua, I want y'all to hear me and hear me good. Y'all stop all that cuteness. Y'all know good and well you got enemies. How is it that you're on the bottom socially and economically and you don't know you have enemies? In order for that to take place, I have to know something's going on. You have enemies. If you don't believe me, go to Psalms 83. Oh, do I need to go there? I know, right? All I hear is lettuce crunching. Always know you have enemies. That's the thing wrong with the nation of Yisrael. Do you not know that every country knows who their allies and who their enemies are? Every nation knows that. What is it about us as a nation? We act like we don't know who our enemies are. You've been in the land longer than anybody, but you've been on the bottom the entire time you've been here. And no, I'm not talking about the white man, because the first thing we go to talk about enemies, and all that, the first thing coming out of mind is white people. You act like the Arabs didn't treat you worse than the during the sub-Saharan slave trade. You act like it wasn't worse than the transatlantic. You might want to go back and read it if you didn't know. When we go back to Psalms 83, did Moses, he tell you who your enemies are? He did not say those that hate you had lifted their heads against thy hidden ones. And that's what we have to remember. Let me tell y'all something. Don't you know if you didn't have enemies, there would be no need for your redemption and your salvation? What y'all think salvation is? Rolling in this floor talking about copper by seal and shaking and all that stuff? That's not salvation. Salvation, let me tell you something. The condition that the nation of Yisrael is in as a people, their struggles, their tribulations, their trials, this is salvation. He's come to save you out of these things. And he's going to do what? Deliver you out of the hands of them that what? That hate you. Y'all don't find it strange? That when you turn on your television, anytime they show you, it's from a negative perspective. That's purposely done. Then don't ever think that the powers that be don't know who you are as a people. Don't ever think they don't know who the nation of Yisrael is and who have served them in these lands. But the Most High told us that these nations shall not serve you again. Am I right about it? But always remember, because I got 3 minutes and I'm fixing to close out with this, Israel, remember who you are and where you are. And keep your heart pure. I don't care what we have to endure, what we have gone through. Your job is not to hate anybody. You are not permitted to harbor hate in your heart. Y'all hear me? You're not permitted to hate anybody. That's not your duty. You're not permitted to seek vengeance against anybody. Because then Yahuwah said vengeance is his. You let him deal with what he's going to deal with. We as a nation, we have to keep our heart pure. And our goal should be striving to learn more and more about Torah so we can be accepted by him. So we can enter back into this covenant with him.